Hi folks, DeeDee Catron here, and I am super stoked to be here with Joggles.com. They are a mixed media online store and have some really great products. They also carry a stellar selection of products from all over the industry, and I'm going to be working on this little art journal spread called Fixed. It's done on these amazing pages, this amazing, super heavy black card paper base that Joggles has found and that they cut to go in these awesome little disc bound journals. And a disc bound journal is cool because your pages come out and go back in really easily, and you can work on them, as you see here, outside of the journal, and then they go right back in when you're done, and you don't have to restring it or re-thread it or rebind it or anything like that. So it's very cool. And this paper is super thick. The two pages that I'm working on today are 3 inches by 4 inches, and they do come in a variety of sizes, so be sure to check that out. Also, the binding cut that they have, you can mix and match, so that's really cool. And the rings, the little discs, they come in two sizes, so your journal can get fatter, it can get really thick if you want it to, or you can sort of keep it on the slender side. So be sure to check that out. I am starting with my go-to gesso. I'm using Liquitex gesso, but I am an advocate of whatever you have or whatever works for you is A-okay. So I am using a thinner gesso. It is a Liquitex brand. It's not heavy gesso, but it has really great coverage. And I'm using a paintbrush to paint directly onto the Joggles black journal page. So my idea here is I'm sort of experimenting and testing out this new to me paper, and I wanted to see what would happen. So both by prepping the surface with gesso, but I'm also using that as a design element, and then I'm leaving the paper raw in some areas as well. So I'm painting on some stripes so that I get these black and white stripes. And what's really cool is generally I'm applying black paint to a white paper, and so I'm working with grungy black stripes, but I get to do the reverse today. So I'm applying, you can see I'm sort of going back and forth a little bit, making the stripes heavier in some areas and lighter in others. And I'm using a dry brush method, meaning I'm not loading my brush. I'm putting a fairly thin amount or small amount of paint into my brush so that I'm not getting heavy brush strokes. And instead, I'm applying a few layers of thin brush strokes to create this sort of grungy effect. Because unlike fluid paints or acrylics, gesso is a base, and I know that I won't be able to pick that back up off the paper very easily. So by applying thinner layers and more of them, it's easier for me to achieve this sort of grungy stroke-like effect rather than completely covering the stripe and then trying to remove some of the paint. Also, I'm applying the paint directly to the paper, and there's no coating between this gesso and the paper, so the paper is going to hold on to that gesso really, really heavily with a lot of oomph, and that also will not allow me to pull the paint up very easily. So again, that sort of more strokes with in a like thinner application makes this an easier to achieve look. Then I've got out a different brush. It's a smaller round brush, and I'm adding some water to my gesso, and I'm going to do a little bit of splattering to sort of help carry that gesso and that white effect over the page. And then also, I really like the look of splatters. I'm a big splatter fan. So load the brush up with water and gesso, and then flick the brush. And it's definitely from the wrist type flick for larger splatters that you like the one you just saw. And then for those smaller ones, it's more about tapping the brush to get some of those smaller sort of all over splatters. And then I'm going to use my heat tool to heat it dry. I do use a lot of heat in between my layers, especially when I'm working in my art journal. You know, you can choose to let things dry 100% natural, and that's absolutely fine. If you live in a warm climate or a dry climate, you can always set stuff outside. Also, that will help it dry. I do live in the desert, but it's spring right now, and so the weather is kind of fluctuating. I just use my heat tool. It's good. It gets me through. Sometimes it does create a little bit of a different effect when it comes to drying. For example, if you use your heat tool on like man-made products, acrylics and plastics and stuff like that, they do have the tendency to bubble underneath the heat. But if you're working in thin layers and if you keep your heat tool moving, you'll be just fine. I'm going to get out my sewing machine now and I'm going to stitch some lines of thread over that area that I have painted. So I've got the black card and then the stripey gesso, and now I'm going to add thread to that. So I'm a huge lover of texture. And I'm just trying to get this in view here and see if I can't, get this so that it reads well in the video. And you'll see specifically what I'm up to. I start off of the card, or I try as hard as I can to start off of the card and stitch all the way across. And in the beginning, I do backstitch. So by backstitching, it's locking my stitch into place so that it won't come off of the journal page. But I realize that that's not a huge concern further in, especially because it's an art journal page and I'm just playing and that backstitching is taking up precious time. Last one here, just about to pull it together. All right. So let's get the sewing machine out of the way. And then I can start trimming up some threads really easily. And I've just got some miniature little Tim Holtz scissors that are going to help me do that. And so where the spine is cut on these pages, that's the part that goes inside. That's where it's bound. So it connects to the discs that way. And I know very specifically as I'm pulling these threads and clipping them so that they can hang a lot more freely and not be bound up together, I'm going to clip that side where the binding is because I don't want it to bind up on the discs. And there's plenty of threads hanging off the other side for me to be A-okay with clipping these off. Now, if you're familiar with my work, you'll know that I don't clip threads very often. I really like them to hang loose and sort of be all over and be everywhere. And that's pretty much become a very big part of my signature. But in this case, the one side has plenty, and I don't want the binding to get all bound up, funny enough. So I do clip those very specifically, just straight off that edge, trimming that up nice and neat so that my pages will flow freely inside my journal. And then I'm going to clip a little bit off of the other edge just so that it's not excessively long. And I am clipping a bit randomly so that they are not all the same length, and move that thread out of the way. And I'm ready to do some more stuff on these pages. So this is my background and I really, really love it. I love the wonky stitching. I love the grungy stripes. I love the gesso on the black. I love the splatters. It's all going really well. I'm going to start building up my background some now. I'm using a water-based Sharpie paint pen. And I'm adding some dots and some other textures in. So where the thread is sort of a, not sort of, where the thread is a 3D texture element, it pops in and out of the page and is really nice. This Sharpie is sort of the opposite. It's a nice texture additive, but it's 2D. It's really flat on the paper, and it just creates a sort of movement for your eye to move around the page. It's a really great design element, and the Sharpies come in all types of sizes, so this one's a fairly fine point, and I can add some really nice detail with it. I am trying to connect the two pages. As you can see, the stripes go across and the thread goes across, the stitching goes across. So I'm doing the same with the Sharpie and just trying to feed this design element throughout the whole page and sort of incorporate these two pages together. This is some sari ribbon. It's a recycled silk. Any type of muslin or anything is going to work really well for this next technique. I am going to add some fibers and some more 3D elements. So I'm using my Tim Holtz piercer to pierce some holes in my page. And so I'm pre-setting where I want to stitch this fiber, this fabric into place. This card is so thick, you certainly need to do this. So if you have an awl or if you have a screw punch or any piercer like this, definitely pre-pierce the holes in the card because it is so thick. It will be so hard on your hands to try and stitch through it without that process. And then I'm just going to trim up. I'm not trimming up specifically, but just cutting this fabric, the sari silk, into thinner strips. I tried to tear it, but I was going against the grain, so it wasn't working. And then, so I end up having to cut it, and then I just rough up the edges with my hands so that they get frayed. And I really love that grungy effect. There you go. And then I'm going to use some DMC floss, and it's just embroidery thread. You can use any embroidery thread or waxed linen thread or anything like that. I do like to use the embroidery thread because it's 100% cotton, and so it has a matte finish, like a smooth finish, where a waxed thread might have where a wax thread might have more of a like a gummy effect. Yeah. So I really like the DMC floss, but I like wax thread also. It really just sort of depends on what sort of finished effect you would like your stitching to have. And you can use any color. I am sticking at this point to the black and white with a touch of ivory. So like a book text and things like that, that sort of vintage off-white color. That's what this recycled sari is. Almost eggshelly, I guess you could say. And I'm stitching that into place. Decided I wanted a couple extra holes to really pull that stitch down the side. And I'm doing a straight stitch with the ends poking out. So rather than the ends being underneath or behind the page, they are on top and they've been knotted for some extra dimension. And stitching's not always the funnest thing to watch. I tried to keep it to a minimum here. Sometimes I'll fast forward through stitching, but this one okay. Not terribly long. I get three straight stitches, and then those ends are knotted. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 holes total. And I have two layers of sari. So then all of the different edges and the frayed areas, they're all sort of playing off of each other and sticking out on the side of this page. And just awesome. So I'm going to knot it here at the end and make sure that it's nice and secure. And I just wrap it around itself and then create a loop and pull that nice and tight. And then I want to mimic the knot that's at the top. So I do it a second time. And I just pull specifically so that that knot ends up really close to the card. And all is well. Clip that off and set it to the side. Now, if you were using like a wax thread here, the wax would help the thread really bind to itself, and you might not have to fiddle so much getting your knot in the right place, but just personal preference. And I love how the black thread is like the from the machine stitching is playing off of the black thread from the cotton. And then I did real quick off camera here, because I already made you watch so much stitching, I just real quick did some French knots on the right side of on the right card, the right page, and you had seen me poke three holes there previously, and so I did just did three French knots, and then this section of sari is much thin of sari is much smaller and more of just a helper to that big section of sari that I have on the left side. And then this is another fabric. So any type of fabrics that you have laying around or beautiful ribbons or anything like that are going to work just as well in these scenarios. This is a muslin, so it's 100% cotton, and it has been rust dyed. That's how it got this really, really incredible orange color. And it's really delicious. So I wanted to thread it or sort of feed it underneath those big stitches. And if I had planned a little bit further in ahead, I would have just put them in place while I was stitching, but that's definitely not how my brain works. And so now I have to try and figure out how to get this muslin underneath that cotton embroidery thread that I made sure was super tight. Yay. I tried to poke it through with scissors, and then I tried to do it with my fingers, and in the end I decide that I will just feed the corner of the cotton through a really large leather needle. When I stitch, I tend to use leather needles because they're thicker and they make my stitching look chunkier and more raw rather than like a really small fine needle for detail. But it also comes in handy because then in this case, I could put the cotton through the huge eye and then thread it through. And look, success. So pull that baby through and fluff it on out. And all is well, looking good. And then I really enjoy just how that, I've got all these layers now. So I've got the card, and then I've got some paint, and then there's Sharpie, and then there's the silky sari, and then there's the cotton thread, and then I've also got these gorgeous rust-colored cotton pieces. So all these textures are playing really well together, and most everything is matte to really complement that heavy black card that's in the back that is my journal base. Except for that sort of silky sari that I've got. There's a little bit of a sheen to that, but it's a nice contrast. So everything's really complementing well together here. And now I'm introducing color into my black and white spread. And I love this color so much. It's very orange. It's super rust colored. And I think we all have sort of this crazy love for rusty stuff. And so it's really extra fun when the rust is in a fabric instead of on a piece of metal. And I'm sort of just checking out here and seeing how my design looks. And I did contemplate tying these in a knot or kind of bunching them up on top of the thread. But I decided in the end that I would just let them freeform here. And because those threads were stitched so tight, they're really holding it in place, holding the cotton in place. So that's nice. And then I'm going to get out now some Dina Wakely Cheddar, and this color is so rust orange. It's perfect. It just lends itself so well. And I've got a little washi tape center here. It's got a double ring, and I'm using it as a mark maker, adding some paint rings to my page. And I'm just going to bring in that orange color now and sort of work it into some areas in my art journal spread. I did decide that I wanted to water down the paint a little bit and see if I couldn't get a bit more splattery type or like more fluid paint ring rather than just very specific paint ring. And I just add a little water to my cheddar, to my acrylic paint, and restamp over the top, and it looks really nice. And I got the exact effect I was going for. And since I already have it out, I'm going to do a little bit of mark making here. And so I'm making some sort of tiny lines. That's just the shape of the paintbrush, the shape of the edge of the bristles. But I already have dots, so I specifically wanted to make sure that I didn't do dots again. So they're just some really small sort of cross, not cross, like I was going to say cross hatches, but they don't cross. So they're more just like straight hatch marks or tick marks. And I'm bringing that orange around and just adding it in various places on the art journal pages, because we have two going here. And I really like working in tandem like this on these two pages back and forth and keeping the design elements from one page to the next. Do a little splattering. And you just water down your paint a little bit to make that happen. And load the brush up. Turning out really nice, and I want to layer specifically some of that orange over those white Sharpies and make that work really nice together. And everything's coming awesome. I'm loving where the page is going, and I'm loving everything that's working together, and it's layering up really nicely. And now I'm going to use the shape of the brush to make some other marks, and I'm going to sort of float them around this paint ring that I have going on. And I do things in odd numbers because in nature, nothing is even and nothing is perfect. And subconsciously, we are all drawn to things that are odd. So I keep things in odd numbers like 3 and 5 and 7. And that's a design element. That's a design concept. And it's practiced very widely. So keep that in mind while you're art journaling. If something ever sort of looks off or looks weird, you know, count the numbers. If there's 2 or 4, sometimes that it may be a simple fix, at like simple enough to take one away or add one more. And again, just heat everything dry so that I can continue to work up. And I'm doing some acemic writing with a number 2 pencil. Any soft graphite will work here. The thicker the lead, we call it lead, but really it's graphite. The thicker that is, then the thicker your acemic writing will be. If you use a mechanical pencil, it could be really nice and thin and dainty. And the softer your pencil, then the darker your writing will be. And then also it's important to remember that I'm working on black card here. So it's where the black is, the graphite looks kind of shiny and nice. And then where I've painted white and the graphite's on top, it's the complete opposite. It's sort of a matte kind of chalky finish, which is really cool as well. Then I'm just going to finish off my page here with some book text words, and I'm using Yoohoo to glue them down. You can use any adhesive of choice, whether it be glue stick or wet glue or a matte medium or collage medium, anything that makes you happy. And that's it for me, guys. I love this page. I love this card I mentioned at the beginning. I had so much fun with it. I'm definitely going to be doing some more of these. So this journal, it comes in different sizes. This paper, there's a 6x6. This is the 3x4. And then there's a nice big chunky one too. And like I said, one of my favorite things about these is that the binding where you clip these in to the disc, they're all cut the same size. So you can mix and match pages too and have a journal that's all kinds of different sizes. And then Joggles has other papers. They have watercolor paper and they have watercolor tags that all have this binding cut into them. And so you can really have a cool mixy matchy journal and or book or whatever you might end up doing with it. So thanks for joining me. Let me know what you think of this. Let Joggles know what you think, and I'll see you again. Here, check out some close-up shots. And feel free to subscribe if you're new. I welcome you to my channel. I'm so glad to have you along. And if you already subscribe, hey, thanks for stopping by again. See ya.